Morning, folks. So, trying something new here. This is 1080p, 30 frames a second. And I'm going to shoot it this way for the blogs. Contour is mounted on a tripod this time. Hopefully it can hear me all the way over here. And I don't know, I was just going to set this up and point at the bike for the morning. One little weekly task that I always do, because that I am cursed with having to live in the Pacific Northwest. No, I'm not really cursed, it's a blessing. Well, it's a blessing when it doesn't look the way it does now. It kind of looks like something out of Stalker, Clear Sky, or Shadow of Chernobyl, when you get towards some place with extreme radioactivity and there's just fog. It seriously looks like the place is like on fire, or somebody has like tons of CO2 or something, dry ice going on. It looks unreal. Anyway. So the lovely thing I'm doing now is taking off tons of little panels and screws so that I can get to the airbox of this motorcycle. Oh shit, this one's stuck. Okay. I don't edit these videos, and I don't plan these videos. So anything happens, happens. Including broken parts. Cussing and all that shit. Okay. No drama. No drama. It came off. Let's see here. Unfortunately, due to space limitations, I don't have enough room behind the tripod to put it further back and higher up. I guess when the days get better, we'll shoot this shit outside, but it's 30 degrees out there, and just having the garage door opens. It's not nice. Actually, it's not horrible, but it's not the best thing in the world either. I'm from a place that's a lot warmer. And I lived in a place that was slightly cooler, but tended to be warm. Definitely not used to seeing my breath at about 11 o'clock in the morning? Something like that, 10, 11, I don't know. I think it's about 11. Motorcycle engine. Now, one reason I'm not explaining what I'm doing here is anybody that comes across this this video and is looking for a piece of motorcycle maintenance tutorial, I'm not your person. No, just kidding. I do all my own work on the bike, with the exception of anything that requires me to go inside these. A little bit here. There we go. That looks like a more engine-ly view. I fucking can't tell. Oh, okay. So SV owners, these things that sit right here on your gas tank, don't pull them off. Yeah, just don't pull them off. Don't remove them. It's a pain in the ass. You'll lose them. It will actually cause the tank to bend and sag at this point over the chassis if you try to ride too long without them. And it causes it to shift around up here on the bolts that hold it down to the chassis. And It also shifts around against your crotch as you lean around on the bike, so don't lose them. Don't remove them. Anyway, so this is a thing that I try to do at least once a week. It's because of the super freezing cold. Many people can't really appreciate what it actually does to a vehicle that has an engine that's less than a liter and then has one working cylinder way over here and the other working cylinder buried way back here. So it's not like the heat of the two is able to, you know, kind of safety in numbers type of thing, you know, group heat. Cylinders close together tend to stay warm together, you should say, or would have a lot more compact heat. You wouldn't have so much cool volume or cool space. What am I trying to come up with here? There's a lot of volume inside of V-twin block that is occupied simply by the scissoring section of the connecting rods between the V, and it's really just open space that you don't have that in an inline engine because everything is stacked so neatly and economically next to each other. Not bagging on V-twins, that's the proper way to build a motorcycle engine. You don't put the damn cylinders side by side. It's new! Thank you, Steve. So this lovely bitty is the object of our affections here, and let's see, get the camera to point towards it. Yes. Okay. So this is the part where I focus on what I'm doing and less on the camera and less on talking and all that shit. Anyway, so what's happening here is this is the breather for the motor, and in this cold the blow-by gases, this engine has 32,000 miles on it, the blow-by gases present that have water in them, they will condense up in here, and if I run the motor particularly hard and it spits up oil, it'll form a white mayonnaise-y shit in this thing. This is a breather filter element. Again, SV owners that think you can alleviate your cold weather problems by removing this and having it open, and oh, there's an air filter on top. No, don't. You heard about it on the internet. Don't. Suzuki put it there for a reason. Leave it. So anyway, you have in here the blow-by gases, and blow-by gases from combustion of gasoline contain water, lots of water. Gasoline's chemical nature contains a lot of, with modern formulations, oxygen and hydrogen because of the ethanols and other oxygenates and whatnot. But the recipe for the output side of stoichiometric ratio combustion of gasoline and air is, like, I think, 8 water molecules or something like that for the proper, like, 14.7 to 1 or whatever. It's a disproportionately high amount of water for something that you just wouldn't normally think of water being present in, you know, a place where there's fire. I can say this much, since IMS 2013 and talking to John Warshaw of Suzuki, started using this crap. It goes in the fuel. It helps get the ethanol and water to stay more mixed. If you've ever poured an extremely heavy drink and you'll notice all the rum or whatever goes to the top, that's because of the miscibility of, I'm getting that word wrong, but the mixability of ethanol and other fluids well, really high isn't perfect, since you see the swirls and all that, and eventually it separates well. Water and gasoline don't mix. Water, ethanol, and gasoline can mix, as we know, but past a certain point, they dephase, and you actually get water sitting in the lower parts of your fuel system, blah, 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 blah. Anyway, how it impacts this is because the water is kept more in phase and the combustion process is kept more in step with how it was when gasoline was just gasoline, there's less moisture here, actually. Combustion of ethanol with gasoline, with moisture in it, releases ungodly amounts of, steam. And, I noticed the difference in the morning. I don't actually get a lot of steam out of the exhaust for a very long time. The engine comes up to temperature and, gets up to, its combustion chambers probably get up to temperature in about a couple minutes, and it's done steaming. Anyway, yeah, that's all. And this is all this moisture mayhem collection. Normally this stuff gets pulled out here through these. Those are pathetic. Really? I may change that someday. Anyway, the gas gets pulled out through these two holes, which that could explain why it collects in there, just generally speaking. These air filters are expensive. It actually behooves you every now and then to pull it out and just tap out the big pebbles. I mean, if you're going to live with your motorcycle and ride it nearly every day, I mean, I think I've rode this thing at least 345 days last year. you gotta come up with economical ways to live with it. Anyway, well, I get sidetracked so easily. Anyway, Startron in the gas keeps the fuel better mixed with itself in the water and whatnot. Also prevents excessive moisture condensation, cleans out the fuel system. One thing it has highlighted for me, and John Warshaw warned me about this, per some of the symptoms that I've had, and Nels at Two Wheel Dental Works, love you, bud, he's the one that actually has been tuning this bike and overseeing the little changes that has been occurring in the past about 15,000 miles that it's been under his tuning care. Got two great mechanics, both kind of suggesting that I have a fuel pump problem. And the use of the Startron has kind of highlighted that. The 5,500 to 8,000 range, if you just really just on it, it's not really there. I mean, it's there, but if you open the throttle too fast, the computer, with its much more aggressive maps, yeah, right, fuel pump's just not keeping up. We look through lots of these here. I know it's the dirty side, but why keep the shit in here? I mean, what's the point? But anyway, thanks to many great minds, I now know that that's probably going to have to come out one of these days, and, probably gonna get it from the usual place. And I don't mean, a dealership, or a stealership, rather, though. The place where I bought this bike, I would have happily bought any Suzuki component from, just for the pure fact that I wouldn't have had to pay shipping, and they would have had it on hand when I went in and asked for it. I'm speaking, of course, Renton Motorcycles, RMC, blah blah blah. Never had these on back order. Everybody else does. Unless you want to go all the way up to North Seattle to order a Suzuki, which, quite frankly, I just don't have time for.
camera. Look.
Does that look like Seattle?
No, it's not Seattle.
It's what we call quote-unquote Renton. When I say quote-unquote, Renton is like fucking 8 miles west of here. They build planes over there. Do you see a damn airplane factory out? Well, you can't see anything out there, but I assure you there's no airplane factories out there hidden in the fog. And if you're wondering why I'm using the star tightening pattern commonly seen on lug nuts for wheels to tighten down the screws of my airbox, it's because I don't want to crack it. Plastic. I don't really care to find out how much one costs, though I'm sure if somebody with the knowledge happened to watch this video and felt so freaking inclined to open their dang mouth, because it is the internet and somebody always has to, at some point in the existence of YouTube, the price of an SV650 K8 SF model's airbox will probably end up in the comments for this video. It is the way of the internet. It will happen. Anyway, I was thinking about going riding this morning, but this fog is so freaking low, it's just not, there's just no clearance between it and the ground, and to me, even though it would be a recreational ride, it almost just doesn't feel worth it, because when you go flipping around a turn, and, oh, that's mine too, the thing in the background, if you can see it. It doesn't run yet. Anyway. Running around in fog like this, in my car, I didn't feel comfortable much going, even really the speed limit. And to be totally honest, this thing's got less visibility. I mean, yes, it's got great LED taillights. I've not seen an aftermarket solution brighter, and I've got brilliant headlights. Just like had to be the cool kid on the cul-de-sac with the BMX bike that was all chromed out, I took all the reflectors off it, because, oh, it's shiny. These aren't too shiny, and I took most of the reflectors off, because I really don't give a shit. My gear has reflective stuff on it. I think, for conditions like this, I'm honestly considering, like, looking at the UK methodology for dealing with fog, how all the cars have that really brilliant but low-mounted red taillight. And, you know, maybe mounting something off the back end of my swing arm, you know, some sort of temporary winter thing, because, yeah, it would be nice to be able to ride and be seen, and it's really collision from the rear that I'm worried about. I'm not really worried about running into things. I've driven in fog enough times in my life, and for enough miles in my life, to know what to look for in terms of traffic around me and all that, to know that, you know, I know what I can get away with and stuff like this, but from a motorcyclist perspective, it's also frozen fog. It's 30 degrees out there. Honestly beautiful, though. It's kind of like going to the Christmas tree farm and they got the flocking. Or if you're us here in Washington, you go to the right Christmas tree farm. It just has snow on it. But, you know, it's kind of cool because everything out here is frost-glazed. It would be cool to take the camera out, but unfortunately, the ice will stick to the lens, and and my visor, and that's kind of the other reason I'm not going out riding today, is because you're just sitting there constantly wiping your visor, and eventually, you know, it just grit from grips, gloves, and scratch your visor up, and, you know, it's just, riding in this stuff is just, it's just a continuous, like walking around in the Sacramento River Delta, or going down to the Amazon, or going down to Mexico, you know, it's just like having little things buzzing around you all the time. You know, when you're out in the cold, you have all these little irritations buzzing around you all the time. And, you know, the last thing you really need to include in all that is the inability to see, which goes for you, the viewer, and me, the operator. I mean, one of my videos I shot, I'll probably upload it, riding to work and going into the fog. And this, by the way, this is why I say don't remove these. Lowering your gas tanks a bitch. Riding into the fog, I think it was maybe two to three minutes into that bit of the footage that the camera is just like, it's really making it look more terrifying than it is. It's like, I can actually see because I'm wiping my visor, but, you know, it's not like I'm going to reach up and wipe the camera and mongle the camera. I mean, that would... that'd be kind of funny, but no, it's not... I'm not doing that. So I cut off the video, but yeah, I cut off the video for security purposes because I work at a freight warehouse, and y'all don't need to know where that thing's exactly located. Especially in this day and age. It was in the news. Seattle Air Cargo, a local competing cargo company with us, they had $21 million worth of Wheez or something stolen. And a word in the industry is it was an inside job. There's rumors flying around that they didn't get their carrier insurance renewed and all that. I don't know how true any of that stuff is, but it's crazy times. I mean, you take the utmost sense of security. I don't have video footage of me actually riding up to my house. If you were some creepy, stalkerish bastard that wanted to try to figure out where I am, by all means, you are, I would discourage you from doing so. It's still a free country, and a certain amendment that allows me to own certain forms of property that send little itty-bitty forms of my property, or forensic material, as you might want to call it, can, remove you from my property. So yeah, don't get all creepy stalkerish on me and try to figure out where I live to cause some sort of malicious intent. Me, like many other motorcyclists, this is insured by Beretta and Progressive, so stay away. It's mine. We hate thieves. But yeah, for security purposes, you know, at work, you know, obviously, even if I did have a concealed carry permit, you know, I couldn't carry at work. It's kind of against company policy, and, you know, most freight warehouses don't have, you know, active repulsory security abilities. You know, by law, we're not really allowed to have it because it's the air freight industry. It's kind of interesting what the federal government has done. We do have means of defending ourselves. I wouldn't exactly say that it's it's an e-ticket ride to the ER to try to walk into a freight warehouse and not belong there. You'll either go home in the ambulance or you'll go home in the back of a black SUV, in which case you probably won't go home, you'll probably just never be seen again. But yeah, I wasn't going to open up the opportunity by taking my video camera places that would reveal too much about where I live or where my work is. And, you know, if you are making a vlog, you know, I would encourage you to kind of think along those lines, because you don't need some creepy asshole showing up at your house if you aren't fortunate enough to own a firearm or a means of defending yourself, or work in a place that a, a simple phone call will have, you know, suits and ARs everywhere in minutes. You know, if you don't have the luxury of, you know, making your own security, don't make your own security risks, I guess would be one thing to take away from this video. I mean, well, yeah, it's kind of interesting. This video is, like I said, I don't plan these. This video is purely like stream of consciousness. You get to see how I think. Some people think I'm crazy. Oh, they might be right, who knows. Anyway, I'm just stalling for time and chatting because, like any little speech class cadet from high school, I really enjoyed the improvisation section. It's fun. Natural born talkers, Geminis, we do that. We like to talk. Anyway, I'm going to dismount the camera now and show you some of the little goodies that actually make Ninetail Ninetail. Well, I actually have the bike apart. First thing is this. And Nels, awesome Nels, went in there a couple times and has made it smarter. What would be the Daft Punk lyric? Well, if I ever want to monetize this video, I can't mention it because that's copyrighted material. Never mind then. Smarter, better, faster, stronger. Anyway, yeah, that thing is just absolutely packed with new knowledge. It's faster, much better. Anyway, it's good for like almost like eight extra horsepower at the wheel. And then this is kind of the other thing. That is the place, that's the air inlet for the airbox, and the thing I just picked up is those itty-bitty holes are what it used to breathe through, and you can kind of see in size reference here, we know what you were doing, Suzuki, you were trying to make this honking V-twin quiet. Thank you for making this ugly snuffleupagus thingy very easy to remove. And the computer easy to reprogram. So the rest of what makes Ninetail Ninetail is that. People poo-poo slip-ons and the value of slip-ons, but if you could actually see all the way down that dark hole, you would be able to see the fact that from here, to actually where these pipes come together is actually all the way open. SV650s, the second generations I know at least, have a baffle restriction in there that has sound insulation in it. And I took the time to remove all that. This muffler is also cut to a precise length such as that the internal volume is about, oh, I don't remember what it was. It was some time ago when I cut it down, unfortunately, and I don't really remember what the golden ratio is. It's a certain, it's like something, it's somewhere between 2.5 to 3.0 expansion ratio in relation to the volume of what's in the cylinders or something like that. So if there's 645 cc's of cylinder volume up front, swept cylinder volume, you have 2x that volumetrically in this can, somewhere between 2 and 3 times that. And the idea is so that the exhaust has, I guess, the ability to generate more scavenging effect. It's just to say that not every muffler you buy off a shelf is exactly tuned for your bike. The amount of volume in the can influences the amount of scavenging for each cylinder, and as this is an asymmetrical firing order engine, you have one pulse that if it's allowed to expand at a certain speed through various parts of the RPM range will respond by helping the next pulse along. And that in turn, if there's enough volume to expand, just enough, it can be exiting the pipe and still exerting a vacuum behind that wave, that pressure wave that it rides out. There can still be enough of a vacuum forming behind that, that it can still get the next, what you would call the long bang, the long duration of a V-twin cycle that's silent, to where it fires again, because it actually is boom, 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 you know, kind of like that, it's asymmetrical. If you can get enough expansion volume to bridge the long part, you can actually get the thing to really, really work for you than against you. And, you know, if you go to the trouble of actually silicone sealing the damn thing so it's actually factory sealed, or sealed like an actual race unit, the factory headers don't flow that bad. You just have to apply a little bit of extra common sense to assembling your motorcycle, I guess. But, you know, the gurus on the internet don't want to believe that, but I could flash a whole bunch of lovely little dyno sheets in front of you that say otherwise. I mean, slip-ons don't make power. Nels does. but having the correct hardware allows you to do so. I don't think you could have done that with stock parts. That's guaranteed. But anyway, those are the things that kind of make nine-tail. We'll be honest, it is faster than a stock SV. I've pulled alongside one on the freeway, kind of give them a ying-ying, and when we pulled away, I pulled away. Is what it is. It's kind of cool, honestly. It means that the bike will also probably not die in the typical fashion of going quietly. I kind of predicted they'll go violently or, you know, explode out the bottom when I go to pull on the freeway at some point or whatever. Or, you know, go to a track day coming out of a turn. Kind of prepared for that. It's sort of what happened to my last motor in my truck. I mean, shit. Got on the gas at one point and a lifter collapsed. There was a lot of kaplang, and then the engine's running kind of rough and a cylinder is shut down. Oops. I haven't actually mentioned that I knew the point of failure for that engine, but yeah. That's the first mention of it in years since it actually happened. Let's test and see how well the camera works. Let's go over here. Had a former roommate. She had a car that she, I don't think she intended to leave it to us, but did. I still need to fix it. But the arrangements for how I got this car are neither here nor there, but they are legal. And it is kind of cool because now I'm the proud owner of a Volkswagen Beetle that has no electronics and crank-up windows. It's fucking awesome. It has crank-up windows. Though, out of respect for its recent, you know, its most recent previous owner, I am actually going to try to resurrect the car, try to restore it. I know she loved Volkswagen, so, you know, I'm going to, you know, it's going to be my baby once I get it going. Engine. It just takes lifting the butt and sticking it in there. The one that's in it, unfortunately, popped a gasket, got pushed too hard, popped a gasket, and dumped its oil on the 405 southbound one night coming home from Red Hook. And yeah, I don't know what's busted inside of it. It may be the topic of a future vlog video, Matt dissects a VW engine. Yeah, it don't run no more. I don't think it actually even starts or cranks. I think it pretty well bearing seized. I know all four pistons are attached to the crank, but yeah, a bearing did seize.
Anyway, I don't know how much time is left on this card. So anyway, let's hurry up and wrap the show up.
I assume, being that the contour is just like amazingly one-button-tastically simple, that once the card runs out of time, being a 4-gig card that came with it, yay for American market purchases, apparently certain countries don't get the card, which I kind of think is unfortunate, but whatever. Like I said, pain in the ass, don't remove them. This is the other pain in the ass, getting the fucking screws back in. I wouldn't necessarily call these bolts are made of cheese. Amen. If anybody at Suzuki is listening, yeah. Your fasteners are made of cheese. Yay, the Cretans of the neighborhood are waking up. Unfortunately, this neighborhood has the cancer known as children. So, that's kind of another reason to wrap it up. I'm not really well loved by many of the parents down there who think that a motorcycle rolling down the street, making a lot of noise, i.e. first or second gear, is going fast. And I'm rather tired of these women that, quite frankly, are probably just dirty little whores in their own right, screaming at me in front of their children. I mean, one, you're not teaching your kids a very good lesson about how to deal with people, and you just look like a crazy asshole, because anybody who has a driver's license or has been around cars for any appreciable part of their life can probably look at a car and tell you, that's going 25. That's going a little bit faster. It's not hard to... Ain't hard to look at a car and say, holy shit, that thing's flying. And I get it from these damn people constantly. Oh. Factory battery still in this bike. What's my secret? I ride it a lot. Most people don't realize that putting your bike away for the winter versus just dealing with the problems associated with the cold. By the way, yeah, I don't think I finished explaining it, but yeah, the problems associated with the cold is the engine just does not get up to temperature enough, you know, because the cylinders are so spread out, everything is so spread apart from itself in this motor, you know. Stuff just doesn't get the luxury of getting warm and staying warm because there's just so much air volume around the cylinders. That's why V-twins lend so well to air cooling. But anyway, it all boils down to the fact that this bike with a radiator and an oil cooler, both exposed to the air, it runs too cold most of the time, and you get water condensation in the engine. So it means you gotta change the oil more often, etc., etc. What most people just don't realize about these vehicles is that, or cars even, because we're just simply not taught about it anymore. It's a machine, yeah, but it's not like a Cuisinart, you know. It doesn't care if you use it every night or once a month. Your car does, a motorcycle does, hell, even your lawnmower does. And where it matters is oil contamination, gasoline quality, quality of rubber seals. Engine components are heavy, and when they're not turning, you know, in a car, crankshaft is, the weight is sitting on a seal.
And a motorcycle, I don't think Ninetale has any seals that carry any appreciable amount of weight. I mean, there's the rear countershaft, but that probably only weighs about a pound and a half at most. Wouldn't think any more than that, Jesus. But, yeah, that's supported on. That's supported internally a lot, so it's not like there's a lot of weight sitting on it. The motorcycles are much higher tolerance than cars. But like my minivan, yeah, the crank just would sit on the main bearing seals at either end, and, you know, that could distort them over time. And so it's like it behooves you to, you know, fire it up and run it, because when it's all spinning, oil, you know, oil is supporting the weight of everything. Everything lifts up and off and all that. You know, it's kind of to say the rubber needs to be exercised. It's like joints. You need to, you know, you need to get up and move around, exercise your joints, otherwise they get stiff.
I am mad with my diesel.
I love living in an area where you have rednecks, because it's the ricer equivalent on a pickup truck. They all have these weird Venturi exhaust things with these cutouts all over them. So when they drive really slow, the way the gas can't escape, well, it can't escape in the way that the tip was designed to. And if they put a high flow muffler on it, the flows are higher, so it'll diffuse out until the velocity is high enough to actually make it go through the Venturi and actually pull through the vent holes or do whatever the hell it is that stupid megaphone thing shaped to do. But when they're cruising around here, they're really freaking loud, and it's, I swear to God, it's the fucking truck equivalent to a fart can just doing anything to your diesel's exhaust. Other than putting big old honking 8-inch wide straight stacks up through your bed, now that's cool. This buttoned up. They kind of want to get inside before all the neighbor cancers start getting out and playing and making noise. And God, I just grew up in a nice neighborhood in California. I grew up with the kids on the street. I didn't have to listen to them, you know, as an adult and think, Jesus Christ, would the little fuckers just jump in front of a damn car and shut the fuck up? I'll admit it, I was a loud kid too, but you know, we had kind of respect for all the adults that lived around there. We didn't run around screaming all the fucking time, the way kids do these days. But yeah, anyway, that's just kind of behooves me to want to get inside and get away from them, because I would just rather not be around them than to have to stand around and think about them, have to look at them. Say check bolt torques every so often. I've never checked those. I checked a lot of things on this bike, actually. Common sense will tell you when something's loose, to be totally honest. Common sense will tell you a lot of things about motorcycles. Bouncing around. I should like totally edit this video and put all my thoughts in order. That'd be kind of funny, but then people would know it's not really me. It's been edited, so it may not be me. It might be like, you know, someone holding me hostage and making me talk. Because if it doesn't make sense, then you know it's dear old me. Anyway, if you apply a little common sense and actually use your vehicle for more than 20 minutes at a time, each time you take it out and use it semi-frequently, and then apply common sense to how you use it, it'll actually last a while. If it's something like a motorcycle, where it's actually built to take a little bit of abuse, to be totally dead honest with you, if you don't get out and thrash it a little bit every now and then,
it'll be kind of like that car that some old lady owned for their whole lives and never took it above 25 miles an hour. The second you take it on the freeway, the top compression ring breaks off on the piston, or on the ring ridge in the cylinder. Because pistons never, you know, completely, you know, there was not enough metal stretch and enough pressure and all that to quite get the rings all the way up to the top of the bore where they should be wearing up to. And same is true for these guys, and that's kind of how I kind of took that to mind when I broke it in, you know. We'll push on it one day, be nice to it the next, push the shit out of it the next day. Yeah, I actually do believe everything is installed, and I've probably burned, most of this card's memory capacity up on this. My hands are freezing. I did bother to open the garage, because, quite frankly, it's dark in here. I got a fluorescent lamp I gotta hang up in here. There's a plug in the ceiling, so why the hell not? Though I can only do so much with this garage so quickly, it's my mother-in-law's house, it's not mine. So people wonder why I have the things that I have, you know, two cars, but I only make $24,000 a year. I live with my mother-in-law, I pay the ultimate price, guys. Well, there's the benefit. I am married to a wonderful woman, but her mom's nuts. She's nice. She's kind of crazy. A little strange. At least to me, from where I'm raised and came from. It'll be awkward if she ever finds this video. Anyway. Gonna shut this shit off, close the garage, go back inside, and pour myself a drink that will hopefully put some heat back in my hands. So yeah, not sure how often I'm gonna do these videos. They're totally impromptu. I'm not really sure if I'm even gonna turn around and watch this one and even like half the shit that's on here. I don't really have the editing software, so I can kind of...